I think the most important thing that has been working for us is approaching football from a business angle. Mm-hmm. I think you've hosted me, you've done interviews with me in the recent past, and I've always kept telling you that we need to start looking at our football from a business angle and mm-hmm. a business perspective, because I believe we are lying on a gold mine locally. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of talent, there's a lot of opportunities, business opportunities, and if at all we don't put our structures right, especially at the grassroots, it becomes difficult. So my drive to just try and maybe approach football from a business angle, especially at the grassroots level, has been the most important thing that has been driving us. And I think the approach that we had in terms of setting up, probably we might not have everything that we need, but at least doing the basic things that we can do, for example, like, you know, just getting these kids, you know, having a professional social media, or maybe someone, a media guy, handling your social media affairs and all that, writing proposals to organizations, companies, just trying to, you know, to ask them to come on board as, you know, share sponsors and all that, and also just, you know, doing everything right, you know. Mm-hmm. A lot of organizations, they want to see accountability put in place, and those are just some of the things that we've been putting in place for our academy, and I think it has given us an edge, because recently, at least now, we are being recognized as academy, and we also have a long-term goal, or maybe 5-year strategic plan of even being certified by the federation, and we know we'll definitely get there. We had some 5-year strategic plans that we had in place, and we have already achieved them in the first year, not even the first year search, but even in just a few months. So I think it's all about just putting your structures right, and just having also the right team to help you manage the whole affairs, because again, alone, of course, I can't do it. We have quite a small team, but again, quality rather than quantity. Mm-hmm. So again, the type of guys you work with will also project your projects will propel your projects into where you want them to get there. And mm-hmm. I think it has really worked out well for us, and we're just getting started.
Okay. Yeah. Now, quite a good point right there. And borrowing from that, you did mention that, you know, looking at sports, we've talked about looking at sports from a business perspective, but we've never talked about looking at sports from a business perspective in the grassroots, which is something that you've mentioned. So how are you able to achieve that, considering even, let's say, mainstream sports really is still way, you know, steps way back, actually a long way from, you know, looking at sports from a business perspective in Kenya?
I think locally it's all about passion. If you have passion for the game, if you have passion, you want to change the way things are being done, nothing will stop you from trying to achieve your dreams. I've recently been saying that I'm one person I'd like to own a club in the Kenya Premier League someday in the near future, which I know it will happen. Already I'm having my own academy, you know, running. And I think the passion I have in terms of, you know, trying to change the game, especially at the grassroots level, has always been my drive. And I'm one person who always believe that if you set your eyes on something, maybe if you set your eyes on the prize, you definitely achieve it. Mm-hmm. And that's the reason why I'm always constantly and consistently just trying to knock doors, just trying to look for opportunities. It might be in terms of education-wise, sports-wise, and all that. Trying to look for the right partners to come on board, the right donors to come on board, because I always believe if we put our structures right, especially in the grassroots, things will definitely change. Currently, if you look at football, I think we are more focused on the top. And I think we should be having an approach whereby we have a pyramid-based system whereby we concentrate so much on the base, so that at the top definitely will be solid. But again, if you look at currently locally, a lot of academies are really struggling in terms of even getting the basic things like shoes, football equipment, accessories. It's so difficult for academy. Look at, in fact, even the type of facilities that we are using. I'm a witness to that, because again, we are really struggling with the type of surface that we have, but we are in the process of working that and working with the school so that they can give us the school field so that we can be using them. And actually, we are on let me say the deal is 99% complete, because I think it's now up to us to finalize and cut the grass and all that. So you find that a lot of academies are really going through hard times, and again, without the proper structures, without the proper support, it becomes difficult for them to try and maybe achieve their goals. And you remember, this is where all the future talents are being are being made. Mm-hmm. So if at all we don't give academies or maybe grassroots football all the attention that it needs, we'll definitely continue complaining year in, year out about the state of our football, especially at the top level.
Okay. Yeah. And the last conversations we've had, of course, before, with many people in the, of course, in the industry, in the sports industry in Kenya, we've been talking about what needs to be done in order to support football, be it the growth of football development, which I'm talking about the role of the media, the role of the stakeholders, and the role of corporates. And since we spoke about that, it was quite difficult at that time to, of course, find, you know, corporates who are interested, which is quite understandable because of the COVID-19 pandemic situation and all that. There wasn't much money going around. But then again, you were maybe successful, quite successful enough in finding a corporate, of course, signing a partnership with one of the energy drink companies, international energy drink companies. And how is it going, considering that? That's why I actually mentioned that the rise has been somehow, I would say, extraordinary, you know, basing it off of, you know, what we've seen in the past year in Kenya.
Yeah.
So maybe what is that like at the moment?
Thank you so much. To us, I think we are one of the lucky academies, or lucky, or maybe, let me say, football teams to even... we can afford to say that we have a shirt sponsor, because it's something that if you look at local football at the moment, a lot of academies, a lot of clubs, even at the top level, are struggling to even get something that we have on board. Mm-hmm. So on my end, I think what really worked well for us is, first of all, the accountability, and also corporate, they want to look at the value. You might not be able to give them the exact value that they want, but mm-hmm. at least they can see how structured, how well structured you are. Because, for example, in our situation, we just did a proposal to Maxfly, which is a Turkish-based energy drink company, setting itself in Kenya. Mm-hmm. And they were really impressed by our structure, and they requested to come on board so that they can, you know, have a view, have a look at our team and all that. They came and they did, they were witness that we are really trying to do things right. And actually, that's what really attracted them to us. And also, they did their own due diligence, and so that, you know, this is where probably we can get some value. Mm-hmm. And to us, it's something big, because that was part of our 5-year strategic plan. In fact, I knew probably we'll achieve it maybe in the fourth year, fifth year. We've done it in just a few months.
Yeah.
And it's all about just accountability, knocking doors around, doing the right proposals, having the right team behind your back, having a right structure in your academy. You know, and I talk about structure, you know, you should have the right team that's helping you manage some of these things, mm-hmm. especially starting from the technical staff, the coaching staff, the backroom staff. We even have a media team in our academy. Something that doesn't really happen in
it's such a young stage, especially considering maybe even some of the local, you know, top teams in Kenya.
Don't even have that. Yeah,
exactly.
So it's all about just doing the basics, doing the right things. You're not doing anything extraordinary. You're just doing the right things that actually are basic, that should be done, especially at the grassroots level and at the top level. And we are still not doing them as such, looking at other teams. Mm-hmm. So I feel if you do things rightly, definitely you'll be able to attract the right sponsors, or maybe the right donors, or maybe the right supporters coming into your team. And it's all about, again, just going out and knocking doors, doing proposals, you know, throwing them everywhere. You never know who, where your luck might be. And I think it has really worked well for us.
Yeah.
And we are grateful, because we signed a 1-year kid sponsorship deal with Maxfly, who came through for us. And we're really grateful, because some of the stuff that we'll be benefiting from Maxfly actually are very huge. And it actually lifts off a huge burden for me, because before, everything used to come from my pocket and all that, or maybe a different well wishes. But right now, at least for the next 1 year, of course, subject to renewal, we'll be looking forward to enjoying our partnership, and also, you know, just giving our sponsors the value that probably they'd want from us, and also us just trying to maximize the opportunity and make the best out of it.
Okay. Yeah. Now, assuming, of course, the burden they've taken off of you, of course, as you've mentioned, now looking at this strategy that, of course, we had talked about the long-term strategy, but as you mentioned, we expected it to happen, you know, at the later stages, of course. But now, does that change other aspects, like, does that change the recruitment, let's say, pattern that you're going to do it more at the moment? And considering the COVID-19 pandemic, whereby, you know, there weren't a lot of sports really being played, except, you know, in the States and all that. So maybe how has it been in terms of recruitment, and is it going to change? Are you going to, you know, first base it, or what's next?
Not really. I think... for us, it's all about just doing things strategically, the way we had planned. At the moment, you find that when we started, actually, we started with, I think, three kids who came. And we were like, we really get the numbers. And before we know it, we actually now have like 30 kids, or maybe let me say 30 players. And we've even been forced to lock the door. Because again, the interest is so high. A lot of people, you know, want to bring their kids from different places and all that. Mm-hmm. But again, for us, it's all about, not even about quantity, it's about quality. Mm-hmm. Because we'd rather work with a limited number, but give them the service, you know, that, you know, they deserve. Instead of working with a large number, but you're not able to cater for each and everyone. So for us, it's all about strategic approach in terms of from recruiting the players to managing our affairs. Because right now, at least, we are done with a few hurdles that we had before, and now it's all about now focusing on the next hurdle. Now the next hurdle, definitely, we'd definitely like to attract more sponsors coming on board, mm-hmm. and we believe our shirts will be full of, you know, sponsors left, right, and center.
Yeah.
And something that is possible. So we are not yet satisfied with the way everything is done, because we are still hungry for more, and we believe we can achieve more. So this is just a step for us into the right direction, of course, mm-hmm. but we are still focused in terms of our strategic plans, one after the other.
Okay.
Yeah.
We're going to be getting back to that later on, of course, Afro Sports Academy, but let's get into maybe some of the other initiatives that you've been, you know, juggling about. And there was an association with, of course, Emerging Stars, yeah. Which, just to be clear, it's not Emerging Stars, the one associated with, of course, Football Kenya Federation. Maybe, Rod, you can tell us more about that and, you know, clear the air in regards to that.
Yeah, a lot of questions have been asked about Emerging Stars Football Academy, because I've been told, you know, you have an academy, why mm-hmm. are you working with a different academy and all that? Uh-huh. But people are not understanding this football business at the end of the day. Mm-hmm. And that's why we are not really, it's something that we are trying to change. It's a cycle that we are trying to break here in locally, because you find that probably teams don't want to partner and all that. So for Emerging Stars Football Academy, I'm their brand ambassador. They approached me to work with them, and it's quite a very exciting project that they have. Mm-hmm. I'm coming in through as a brand ambassador. I was also, just having retired from the game, I'm also trying to pursue my coaching, mm-hmm. my coaching
of course.
Papers and all that. Mm-hmm. And I'm also coming in as a scout. So Emerging Stars have given me an opportunity to try and work with a bigger academy, because I mean, with all due respect, mm-hmm. they have quite a big structure. And as Arrow Sports Soccer Academy, we are partners to them. Like, they are our big brothers. So we also stand to benefit from them being our big brothers. And if you look at clubs like Manchester City, you know, Man United and all that, they have different small clubs in different countries, whereby in different continents, mm-hmm. whereby they use them as their feeder clubs. And mm-hmm. it's an approach that we are trying to also create back here at home, whereby if you find like probably a big club, or maybe a big academy with mm-hmm. bigger dreams and maybe bigger structure, and that can offer you all the support in terms of even coaching, in terms of infrastructure, kits, because Emerging Stars Football Academy, they train at St. Mary's. If you go to St. Mary's, St. Mary's is one of the best facilities we have around. Mm-hmm. Actually, having played Premier League for the last 13 years,
yeah.
I've never seen quite a surface as
yeah.
good as that.
Yeah.
And it's actually a good opportunity for some of these kids who will be joining Emerging Stars Football Academy to try and use that facility.
Mm-hmm.
For example, even us as Arrow Sports Academy, during the open day, we got an opportunity to take our kids for the open day, Emerging Stars Football Academy open day.
That was actually this weekend?
No, it was the other weekend.
Oh, the other weekend.
Yeah, and the kids were so surprised because they've never seen such a surface before. And that's the type of motivation you want. Because every time they're like, I want to play on such a surface when I become a bigger person.
Mm-hmm.
And so Emerging Stars Football Academy, one of the best academies that we have around, with a good structure in terms of management, has like 7 directors, 3 are in the UK, the rest are here in Kenya. And we're just trying to, in terms of change the way football approach is being done, especially in terms of football management and football coaching, because it's a team that has a lot of diversity, a lot of networks. We have a registered agent back in the UK. We also have a whole big team, marketing team and all that. We, the coaching staff, we're being led by our technical director, Mr. Ryan, all the way from Ireland. I mean, very much experience, rich experience and all that, a UEFA qualified coach. And there's no better person to learn from, you know, than Mr. Ryan. And also it's an opportunity for me because Emerging Stars, they've offered to like take me through all my coaching courses up to the highest level. You know, so long as we align in the same goals and all that, everything is good. So to me, it's a good opportunity for me to develop in my next phase of life, because mm-hmm. they've offered me another opportunity to work in football, but in another perspective, not as a player, but mm-hmm. as a coach, as a brand ambassador, mm-hmm. and as a scout. So it's quite a huge project. We recently, yesterday, the other day, we did our tryouts. quite a huge opening because we had like 130 players turning up for the tryouts.
That is for emerging stars.
Uh-huh. Quite a huge number. And we are supposed to do our technical meeting tomorrow and just decide on the way forward. So God willing, we'll be having all the academy, all the teams, all the way from 6-year-old, you know, 10-year-olds, 11-year-olds, 15, and even a senior team, if everything goes to plan. But the end goal is definitely to just try and create a pathway for these kids to go all the way and play professional football. They might not play professional football as such, but probably they might end up in colleges in the United States, mm-hmm. or maybe even get, you know, better job opportunities. Mm-hmm. And also an opportunity for us as Arrow Sports Academy to also import all our best talents to Emerging Stars Soccer Academy. Because also, you remember, we are partnering with St. Mary's, a private school, and there's sports scholarship on offer. So again, if you give a kid, or maybe two kids, sports scholarship, whereby they'll be learning all the way through from primary to secondary school for free, I mean, it's a huge plus. So mm-hmm. Emerging Stars Football Academy, they have some quite huge plans, and we're definitely looking forward to that.
Okay, you've mentioned about taking the kids professional to professional football, of course, and you've mentioned the structure. Do you believe, because, you know, everything about maybe the scholarships, those are added perks that, you know, most soccer academies or even generally sports academies do not possess here in Kenya. So can you say maybe the international structure that, you know, Emerging Stars is based off its operation, can you say that's advantageous as considered to, you know, the usual model that we use to...
Yeah, true. It's definitely they have an upper advantage in terms of the structure, because if you look at some of the approach that we are taking at Emerging Stars Football Academy, it's definitely top stuff. You know, professional best on probably a European, even a Premier League club, mm-hmm. and it's something that we're trying to approach to also imply back at home. Mm-hmm. But again, you find that not everything can work, because mm-hmm. you find that in Europe they have almost everything. But again, here, there's some things we lack. So we're just trying to, you know, pick the positives. Whatever we can apply back here at home, we apply them. And so far, so good, because the approach has really been professional, has really been top-notch, starting from the management to the coaching staff and also to the playing unit. Mm-hmm. And also, you see, it's something that even us as Arrow Sports, we are borrowing from, because we are learning from our big brothers. Mm-hmm. And if at all we can apply the same approach that they have, at our grassroots level, definitely we are bound to change things, and we are really trying to encourage a lot of academies to try and use the same approach, because it brings a lot of opportunities, mm-hmm. and a lot of networking and all that. And with a lot of opportunities, again, you find that academies will be able to have all the right equipments, accessories, and also the right networks that they need in order mm-hmm. to achieve their goals at the end of the day.
Okay. Now for Ronald, of course, he is trying to give back to the society, or rather Kenyan football, as he's a former player, Gor Mahia, Western Stima, and most recently, before he retired, once again, as he claims, he used to play for Sofapaka as a forward. And of course, we've seen a while back you were telling us your story. You've told people all over, even on Twitter. I remember you did a thread about when you started and all that. Can you say that is why you're so, you know, committed to growing the sports, considering you're also involved in another sports academy?
Yeah, sure, without a doubt. I mean, my career alone has been full of a lot of resilience and hard work, because I'm one person who considered myself 90% hard work and 10% talent. So we had to really work extra hard to get the opportunity. And looking at my pathway, I actually never even got an opportunity to join an academy, because it was all about, you know, your passion and your hard work, because back then in our country we never had any academy. So again, when we moved to the city, that's when I actually realized there are a lot of huge opportunities in terms of football, because that's when I joined a team called Salem Sportive, and then later moved on to Jericho Stars. So if I look at my career, I had a lot of challenges trying to get an opportunity and all that. And for 13 years, I think the challenge, they definitely helped me, gave me an edge to realize that there are things I can do differently, mm-hmm. to try and make it smoother for the next generation of athletes. And that's why I decided that now that I've hung up my boots officially, mm-hmm. I'm not going back into the game. This is an opportunity for me to try now and help the game, or maybe just do things differently, especially at the grassroots, so that we can give the next generation of athletes, the next generation of footballers, opportunities that are smoother, and a pathway that mm-hmm. is smoother than the one that we faced. And we are so grateful, because through my networks, or maybe through the links that I managed to create over all those years, because again, when you're playing, that's the right time for you to create the right networks that you will need once you've retired from the game. And so far, so good, because, I mean, I'm now in a position whereby at least I can give a certain kid somewhere, or maybe some kid somewhere, mm-hmm. A better opportunity than the one I got, mm-hmm. especially while I was starting out my career. Because, I mean, being a player and you don't even have a management team to maybe try and manage your affairs, you don't even have an agent, you don't even know you don't know anyone in any club, you're going for tryouts, being dropped left, right and centre. I mean, if you're not really focused enough, you can give up. But again, with what we are offering right now, mm-hmm. at Roads to Goals as an organization, we're definitely bound to give some of these kids a smoother pathway in terms of trying to achieve their dreams. And that's that has always been my goal.
Okay. Yeah. Now, Roads to Goal. Roads to Goals, of course. You have Afro Sports Academy.
Yeah.
You have Emerging Stars. And you also have Kombora Sports Academy. So maybe you can talk about your involvement or whether your role in Kombora, you know, Sports Academy too.
Yeah, Kombora is actually a brand, is a sports brand. They make sports apparel, but basically they make footballs. It's a US-based company owned by one of our former legends, John Baresi. Mm-hmm. We call him Baresi Odhiambo, a very well-known back in the days, mm-hmm. currently now residing in the States, and he came up with his own company whereby they make footballs, because he saw an opportunity and he decided to grab it. So that's why he came up with Kombora Sports. And Kombora Sports is basically a sports apparel whereby they produce footballs generally, maybe you know, the shin pads, and hopefully they're manufacturing even uniforms very soon. Mm-hmm. And God willing, they will be the first academy to don the Kombora uniforms, of course, as a brand ambassador.
Hopefully.
Yeah, so it's just a brand of balls. A brand of footballs that are trying to penetrate the Kenyan market, and as the brand ambassador, I'm helping them to try and, you know, market the brand, especially locally. And it has been well received, especially by the grassroots teams, because we have this season alone, they produced like two footballs, Ultra and Valiant, very quality balls, especially built for the surfaces that we have locally. Mm-hmm. Long-lasting ball. I mean, balls that can be played during the rainy season, maybe even the dry season and all that. And it's an opportunity that we are looking at even going forward in the future, whereby we'll be approaching our local FA to maybe just try and give them some of these footballs that they can be using at the official match day balls.
Supporting our own issue.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. The official match day balls of the Kenya Premier League. Because as you look at currently, I mean, we don't really have like an official match ball. And we are thinking going that way. And so far so good, because in terms of business wise, we imported like I think almost 300-400, and right now we only have 4 left, mm-hmm. in the store. So we're looking into the next shipment, mm-hmm. next month.
Okay.
Yeah.
And now in Kenya we have, of course, every athlete's dream, once they're done playing professionally or once their time is over, we all know that an athlete lasts for a certain period. Yeah. Durability, for lack of a better term, once again. But then again, what can you credit to maybe the fact that not most sportsmen have that opportunity to maybe get a chance to give back to society? Because we only know of a few. We have the likes of Musa Otieno, we have, yeah, the likes of Mohamed Musa, and then we have the, yeah, likes of you. Why is it that maybe sometimes they don't feel like, you know, justice was done unto, yeah, them? By justice, I don't mean the legal way. You, yeah, you know what I mean,
yeah,
of course.
I know.
Yeah. So does it contribute to maybe them seeing that, you know, I actually have nothing to give? So it's,
yeah, good question. Actually, that's true, because it does. Looking at a lot of former players, again, you must look at the current situation that most of them are in. I mean, during the playing years, they actually first went through a lot, and they left the game with mixed emotions, and some of them would not even like to be associated with it anymore because, again, of their past experiences. But I believe, you know, everybody has their own story, and for me, it was so different because I'm so passionate about football. Mm-hmm. It has given me a lot of opportunities. And I think even the first interview we had with you definitely came because I was a footballer.
Yeah,
and,
exactly.
I came to get a lot of opportunities in life that I never even thought that I could get. Looking at my career, I never played for the national team. I never even played professional football outside. But I'm really contented with everything I've achieved locally, because I know what local football means to me, and I know all the opportunities that it has given to me. From the first club that I ever played for to the last club, I owe all those clubs all my life and everything, because it's through them that I came to, you know, get opportunities. Through them that I get to even live my dream of playing local football. I had dreams of playing for certain specific clubs, and it came to materialize. In fact, the last one just came 5 months ago, and I officially got down with Sofapaka, a team that I always wanted to play for the last 10 years. And I got the opportunity finally at my later stages of career. So I think it's all about how passionate you are about, you know, still getting involved with football, especially in your next phase of life. And for me, I could have gone and done something else. Of course, I studied information science at Kenya Methodist University, but right now, whatever I'm doing, whatever I studied, I totally told off apart. So it's all about just the passion that I have still for the game. And there are a lot of opportunities that exist after football, because people just think that, you know, you can just be probably coach, you know, football agent, but there are quite a lot of, you know, huge opportunities that exist immediately you're done with football, because you can still work in different, you know, departments and all that.
Exactly.
And to me, I still want to get involved in football, and there's no, it has come at a better time. That's why actually I hung up my boots while people are telling me you still have some few more years left. But to me, I was so much contented, because now I'm so much focused on grabbing all these other opportunities that exist in the next phase of life after football.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's actually great.
Thank you so much.
But then again, looking at maybe what you went through as a player back then, and even though you didn't get maybe a chance to maybe play professionally out there, or even for the national team, maybe what can you say has, you know, relatively changed, considering even nowadays, even for the national team, we have, you know, motivation sponsors for, that was actually quite new, because actually as we speak, Football Kenya Federation is, you know, launching Harambee Stars, the motivation sponsor partner this morning. Of course, it's a far park. So besides that, what are some of the things you can point out that, you know, have really come a long way in Kenyan football?
I think we must also look at the positives. As much as we have on our own challenges, locally we've had our own very big challenges, but again, I always choose to focus on the positives. Personally, even in my career, I've had all those challenges, but I must always just pick the positives. For example, even our federation, I think we must give them a pat on the back, because they're really trying in terms of, you know, change things. They might have their own challenges, yes, but I mean, they're really trying to outdo themselves, because if you compare what we had before and actually what we have currently, we've really made some...
We've come a long way.
We've made some steps. So as much as people sometimes don't want to acknowledge them for doing that, but honestly, they've done their part. And I think it just shows that there are quite a lot of opportunities, there are quite a lot of partners that are willing to come into the game, because you find that right now, like, they're launching a motivation partner, which actually is good, because I mean, it comes with perks, and you know, with perks again, who's bound to definitely benefit?
It's
the player. It's the player at the end of the day. So it just shows that there are a lot of opportunities, there are a lot of partners who are willing to come and support the game. It doesn't matter how, they just want to come in and just, you know, promote the game. At the end of the day, you know, it's business at the end of the day.
Yeah.
They gain, and also the teams gain, and also maybe the federation gains, and also, you know, the players gain. So to me, I can encourage a lot of, you know, corporates, a lot of organizations to come through. Now we have, it's a betting partner that's coming on board as a motivation partner. We've also had Max Fly coming through for us, and we have many, many other corporates who are actually just waiting to be shown that, you know what, there's accountability here, and now you can just come and throw everything into the kitchen sink and just support the game. Because actually, as we speak currently right now, a lot of clubs, a lot of players, a lot of, you know, teams at the grassroots really need that corporate help. And the only way they can come through for us is if at all we show them that actually we deserve, you know, the help, and that if at all also we show them that we have some value to give them in return.
Okay. Now we have two more points to go, of course, and I did mention a while back when we were talking about Afro Sports Academy that we would be coming back to that point, because you mentioned something quite interesting. It was about scouting.
Yeah.
And that in Kenya has been a major issue, because even when players are being selected for the national team, you always hear some, you know, some factions of, you know, of the stakeholders saying, hey, we did not do well in terms of recruitment, in terms of we have a, you know, a bigger pool, a very big pool actually of football players, but we're not doing enough to make sure that, you know, they get to showcase their talent even for the, while playing for the national team. So maybe you can talk a bit about that, and, you know, the scouting systems, even you know, in the structures of, let's say, a sports academy such as yours?
True. I think it's something that we've been lacking, especially over the years. There's a lot of talent at the grassroots, but they never get to be given the opportunity to maybe just try and express themselves. Because personally, myself, I was a late bloomer. I never got the opportunity while I was that young.
Yeah.
I came to get them while now I'm matured, and I feel that, you know, I'm ready to go and fight for with men at the table so that I can grab the opportunity. But if you look at a lot of young talents, they're not really being recognized as such. And I think in terms of our scouting, we really need to up our game, because I don't even think if clubs really have scouts, and probably maybe just a few, probably Mother United, Karibangi Sharks, they've been doing the recruitment well in terms of giving the young lads an opportunity. And it's an opportunity that personally I worked with Emerging Stars Football Academy, and we saw it worthwhile that I can come on board as a scout. Mm-hmm. And actually through Emerging Stars, I've already completed my FA Level 1 Talent Identification, which actually I got a certificate just recently. And we're just trying to, you know, get the knowledge in terms of knowing how to scout, knowing how to identify a good player, because there are a lot of good players, especially at the grassroots, but they're not really being given the opportunity because probably they don't know anyone, or probably, you know, somebody somewhere has missed some critical detail about them. And I believe it's something that if you can do right, especially in terms of recruitment at the grassroots, giving these young players an opportunity, we are bound to have a very bright future in terms of even our national team, in terms of even our clubs, because we are now looking at a situation whereby a lot of clubs are in the restructuring processes. And you find that the older generation, let me call myself the older generation, we are now facing out, and actually the new kids on the block are coming in, and we need to give them the opportunities. And by giving them the opportunities, we must, you know, recruit them from the grassroots, and just give all the best talents that we have the opportunity equally, irrespective of the background or maybe the, you know, education, or maybe class and all that they come from. Give them according to merit. And by giving them according to merit, by just identifying talent the right way.
Okay, and I'm sorry to go this direction, but it's always a money issue, yes. But is there the minimum, the bare minimum we can do to at least, you know, manage to develop, you know, these talents at the grassroots level? Because where I say the apologies for going this route.
Yeah.
How many sports academies are based in the grassroots? That's my point, because will it always be an issue that we talk about grassroots level football, developing it? Then again, no one is really interested in basing their operations, you know, from...
Yeah, I mean, we have... I can't even give you count, but we have thousands of football academies at the grass, because even you today you can wake up, go and buy stuff and start your own academy. But again, now what will give you the edge, or maybe what will set you apart, is how passionate, how consistent, how persistent you are.
So it's about consistency.
It's about consistency.
You can't actually pinpoint players, you know, like, let's say 15 out of the huge pool of players we have, not only in the Kenya Premier League, in the FKF Premier League, still getting used to saying that, NSL, the lower divisions and all that. So once again, I mentioned, is it a lack of money, or is it just...
I think it's all about consistency, because you might lack the money, but again, if you're consistent, if you're perseverant in terms of what you're doing and whatever you want to achieve, you'll definitely go through it. Because I'll tell you for free, running a football academy is not easy. It's not an easy task, because there are quite a lot of logistical issues, financial constraints, and a lot of challenges that come in through. And now you can imagine just running a fully fledged football club, playing in the league or maybe in the top league. That's why you see a lot of clubs actually are really struggling in terms of even financially, financially getting the sponsors to come through, and it's really tough. For example, I can give an example, like just honoring a league match fixture in the Kenya Premier League, you'll spend almost 350k.
That's a single match day.
Yeah, a single match day every weekend. And you can imagine how many matches you have throughout the whole season. Mm-hmm. So some of these clubs, they're really struggling, and they're really trying to, you know, give their best. As much as people say our football is still lagging behind, but again, if you look at the dynamics that surround some of these clubs, surround some of these chairmen, some of these club president, they go through a lot. Mm. And I'm just running a grassroots academy.
Now you understand.
But I can feel it. But now I understand how tough it is to run a football club or maybe to run a football academy. Mm-hmm. But what I've also, the experience that I've had, I think it's all about consistency. and being persistent, mm-hmm. and also just you know, doing your things right, just trying to put your structures right. The basic thing you can do, you do it, because at the end of the day, if you have a business-minded, if you're a business-minded person, if you're looking at football from a business angle, you won't just be satisfied with the way things are. You try and go a step further to knock doors and maybe just trying to bring the right people on board.
Okay. Now, closing remarks in regards to, of course, now that, you know, COVID-19, of course, with the current situation and whatnot, what effect has that had maybe on sporting academies such as yours? Has the numbers declined, obviously, because I understand there was a time that it was totally locked down. You couldn't do anything.
Yeah, for us, I think it was a blessing in this case, because it's during that period that a lot of things picked up on our side, because that's the time that we got the finances, that's the time that I also retired from the game, that's the time that I also had all the time in my life to just try and, you know, execute all my plans. So I know to some academies it might be a difficult moment, a difficult period, but for us, I think it gave us that, you know, that time to just restructure, that time to just put our house in order, because during that time, definitely, there was no football. We didn't play any football. So we just had to wait and use this opportunity during the COVID period to just do, you know, plan, put our strategic plans in place and just, you know, put our targets that, you know what, from January, we're beginning. And things actually worked out well for us because during that period, we put in our plans, and when January came, we kicked off our services and things have been so far going upwards.
Okay. Now, as we wind up looking at your camera, of course, we want to tell you maybe for those interested in joining Arrow Sports, maybe where they can find you, where you train, you know, such information really.
Okay. Currently, we are training at a place called Jerusalem. Arrow Sports, we are a grassroots based football academy, but with a holistic approach. It's not just about football, but you are looking in terms of, you know, a whole child's development process. And if at all you want to join us, of course, this season alone, we have already finished our recruitment. Hopefully, we'll be recruiting again during the December. So if at all you want to just join us, just, you know, you can link with us on all our social media handles, Arrow Sports Soccer Academy. But on the flip side, if you want to join Emerging SAS Football Academy, we are currently having a recruitment process. You can just check out Emerging SAS Football Academy social media handles and just hit them a message. The marketing team will definitely get back to you and tell you our programs in terms of how the kids will be training.
Okay. We also have a few social media platforms of our own, so you can give us your feedback on the show via those on Facebook at KBC Channel 1, or on Twitter. You can tweet us at KBC Channel 1. You can tweet me directly at Munga_Mbatia. Well, thank you very much, Ronald, for giving us the time right here at KBC's Channel 1's Sports Check. And we do hope that indeed we can do a follow-up in regards to the same and see how you guys are doing.
Thank you so much for hosting me. It's a real opportunity and I don't take it for granted. I'm so grateful.
Anytime. Now, for the viewers, of course, don't go too far. We're going to be taking a short breather, but a lot more is in store for you. I'll see you shortly.